Aluminium is the most common metal on Earth, and often the material of choice for most custom keyboard cases. In this video, I'm going to put on my lab coat and get technical. Let's talk about anodizing. My channel is about mechanical keyboards. If you want to join me as we go beyond typing videos, hit that subscribe button. It's going to be impossible for me to cover every nuance of this complex process, but my goal is to help you understand what anodization is and what accounts for the variations in quality that we sometimes see. Just go easy on me in the comments. At room temperature, when exposed to air, aluminium and its alloys will naturally form a layer of oxidation that protects the surface from corrosion. The two most common anodization processes are type 2 and type 3. Type 2 is cheaper and allows for more colouring options. Type 3 is what we know as hard anodizing and is more resistant to wear and corrosion. It's not used very much for keyboard cases, mainly due to the cost and the limited colour options. Aluminium keyboard cases are made out of alloys, so they contain different amounts of other metals such as zinc, magnesium, and copper. That affects the quality of the anodization and the final colour of the metal once it's been dyed. Aluminium from different batches might have some variance, which means colours may not match. Anodizing won't cover up marks left over from machining like powder coat or paint might. They're going to stand out. The corner of my pearl has a mark that might have been left behind from when the metal was machined. It's barely noticeable and doesn't detract from what is overall an excellent finish and a beautiful colour.
Doesn't look like anything to me.
So even before we get to anodization, there are things that could affect the final product. The first step in a typical anodization process is prepping the surface. Machine oils and dirt need to be thoroughly cleaned before the anodization can begin, or they'll be obvious later. My round 1 TX1800 has some barely noticeable marks on the top surface. These might have been caused by the part not being degreased properly prior to being anodized. After the first round of TX1800s, I think the anodizing on the TX board is usually very reliable. My TXCP is flawless in terms of finish and the consistency of the colours on the two halves of the case. Etching removes any natural oxidisation, and acid etching can give the surface a nice matte finish, helping to smooth out imperfections. It's also gentler on the aluminium than alkaline etching. Residual chemicals and aluminium sludge, known as smut, left over from etching need to be cleaned off in what's called desmutting. I'm ashamed to say, I find this word highly amusing. On to anodization. Electricity forms a layer of oxidization that's much more durable than the one which forms naturally. As you can see from my diagram, direct current is passed through a solution that conducts electricity, usually an acid. I think any electric type Pokemon will work, but Pikachu provides reliable power, and that's important. Our keyboard is the anode in the circuit, hence the name. Oxygen is released at the anode, which builds up a new layer of aluminium oxide. The acid slowly dissolves the aluminium oxide and allows the process to continue deeper into the material. This produces tiny pores that we can fill with the dye before the surface is sealed. Current and the surface area of the parts and the rack need to be calculated. That could be a whole video on its own. There also needs to be a good contact with the part so current enters it properly. Poorly thought out racking or a case that's a tricky shape might leave marks that are unsightly or an inconsistent finish once the part is dyed. Be aware that rack marks are usually unavoidable. My new Mini looks like it's been in the wars, with some discoloration near the screw holes and a few scratches and dings. They're all on the inside of the case, so I wasn't too bothered about them.
Doesn't look like anything to me.
KBD Fan's anodizing has improved a lot since I bought mine, judging from the photos I've seen of their tofu boards. Now the dye can do its work, filling in those pores before sealing. So you can see that getting consistency takes a great deal of care and attention at every step. The chemicals used need to be controlled so that we have consistent results. pH, temperature, current, all need to be just right.
Nobody knew that
anodizing
could be so complicated.
Huge shout out to my mate, the raging Malaysian, Anthony from 001 Keyboards. He inspects the finishes on the boards he builds very closely and has made me much more aware of these kinds of things. I found that this hobby becomes a lot cheaper if you make a conscious effort to be super fussy. Check out his builds and unboxings on Twitch and YouTube to compare finishes from pretty much every board that comes out and hear useful insights on quality. Also thanks to Kubacek, who I contacted about this video over 5 months ago and who very kindly answered my questions in great detail. We've seen standards raised for anodizing from most designers and manufacturers, and that's great. As buyers, if we know more about what goes into anodizing, it means we can appreciate our keyboards a bit more too. Well-informed consumers raise standards and can judge value for money that much better, so we're more likely to be satisfied with what we get when we finally open the box. Feel free to focus on the important issue of the spelling and pronunciation of the metal in question in the comments. I'll see you next time.